Yeah, hello, welcome to this webinar from Signpost 6 with Robert Anderson. I'm Rosine van Os. I'll be interviewing Bob today. We will discuss insider investigations with the most experienced professional in this domain. He's a recognized expert in cybersecurity, incident response, cyber hacking, counterintelligence, and economic espionage matters with nearly 30 years of experience in law enforcement. Bob, I would like to ask you first some general questions about the subject based on all your experience.
Sure.
Very generic, but could you just explain to me the different forms of insider threat that you've encountered so far? And also how it's different today, maybe from your past towards today?
Yeah, I think it's a good question. And insider threat, depending if you're sitting inside a government organization that potentially has confidential or classified information, is slightly different than what I would consider insider threat to corporations that have intellectual property or material that they've developed to go to market to in a very near future, and they're worried about competition stealing it. Traditionally, in the US government anyway, when we look at insider threat inside United States government organizations, we're talking about spies. We're talking about people that are trying to steal classified information, and for most part, provide that to a foreign nation outside of the government that they steal it from. In today's private sector market, when we talk about insider threats specifically, I think there's a couple versions of this. And in some cases, individuals that are inside corporations could be there intentionally to try to steal intellectual property or trade secrets. They may or may not be working for a foreign power. They may be working by themselves. They may be working within groups. And then the other side of insider threat is the conscientious employee that is trying to do everything right, but because of their daily job and their hectic life, they click on something wrong or they access some website that downloads some type of malicious software that steals technology from that company. So there's a subtle difference. And the big difference for insider threat nowadays compared to 15 or 20 years ago. 20 years ago, for somebody to actually steal anything from a US government or foreign government organization, or even a private sector company, they had to physically be there. They had to go in and somehow access that information and then surreptitiously bring that information outside the company. And I think we'd all agree in the last 15 or 20 years, especially in the last 4 or 5 years, the increase of data, technology, and the dark web controlling a lot of the hacktivist organizations and criminal organizations that are stealing this technology has changed the entire way we look at this.
Yeah, absolutely. Another question is, you've arrested dozens of spies. You've mentioned espionage as well just now. Can you just say what are common factors among them? What is something that you always see again and again?
Well, I would like spies, when we talk about traditional spies, into two or three different categories. And, you know, the one thing I would say to your audience is what people need to realize is I think most people think we've arrested, you know, just a couple spies. Unfortunately, that's not the case. Spying and spies are rampant. I mean, just Monday in the United States, the FBI arrested a New York City police officer for spying on behalf of China. And let me tell you something, this is 1% of what's going on and what actually gets out to the papers. Spying and different types of spies, in my opinion, have two or three different reasons for becoming a spy. And when I say spying, I'm talking about traditional spies that are trying to steal classified information. One is, and a good example of this is Ed Snowden, who really believes in his mind that he's doing something righteous or something that he feels is the right thing to do, even though it's violating or breaking criminal statutes, not only in the United States, but around the world. Another type of spy is Robert Hansen, who was an FBI agent that we arrested back in 2001, who became a spy because, quite frankly, he was angry. He was angry at the FBI. He was angry for not being promoted. He thought that he was smarter than his supervisors. As a matter of fact, this came out in a lot of the briefings and interviews. So he started spying for Russia. Okay, well, as I was saying, I think otherwise spies do it for monetary reason, like Nicholson and his son, who actually have been rearrested in a federal prison by myself and others, still spying for Russia. And they were purely looking at it for an economic gain. So traditional spies, I think, do it for three reasons. When we talk about spying, though, for intellectual property and the private sector, I think the majority of that happens for two reasons. And personally, I think that's why the private sector and companies and boards and CEOs really should look at this significantly nowadays, is because primarily it's for all economic gain, or from a nation state, it's primarily to beat a corporation to the marketplace and then undercut them when they sell their product, because they don't have to invest all the R&D cost to it. And that's really the difference between traditional spying and private sector intellectual property and trade secret spying. And the one thing I can tell you clearly, which really bothers me, and it's the same here in the US as I think everywhere, is 10 years ago, boards and CEOs really didn't invest the time or the money into cybersecurity. And I think we've all seen that change. But really, I see very few companies looking at insider threat seriously. And I think they really should do that, because it can devastate a corporation.
Thanks, Bob, and I'll get back to that in a moment as well. And saying that it's so important, can you just give some glimpse of how significant espionage activities can become within companies? How complicated or sophisticated will nation states get to steal trade secrets?
That's a great question, and I will tell you, unbelievably sophisticated. China, which is rampant in the United States for stealing trade secrets, and for years, different parts of the FBI that I ran, we have investigated and arrested hundreds and hundreds of individuals in this country for trying to steal or stealing trade secrets or intellectual property. And China, more so than Russia, Iran, and other countries that are very active in stealing or trying to steal intellectual property also, is extremely sophisticated. You will see multiple individuals inside of the same company. Those individuals may or may not know that there's anybody else in the company working for China. So they have compartmentalized if somebody is ferreted out, either by the corporation or by federal law enforcement. That it will not compromise the entire operation that's going on inside that company. They will take years to embed and train people to go inside specific corporations to steal specific technologies. And then, of course, the cyber aspect of this is simultaneously they will have individuals working to hack into or compromise systems inside of companies throughout whatever sector they're trying to steal that technology. So these operations are extremely sophisticated. And quite frankly, very hard for any corporation to even pick up that they're going on inside their organization. And one of the things that we've talked about obviously before, and I think it's necessary, is the need to be proactive in the private sector, especially when you have intellectual property or technologies that are keys to your kingdom, to having a plan in place in case this ever happens.
Thank you. And you already mentioned China. There is a strong focus on China at the moment, in the last couple of years especially. You mentioned, I think, also a different level of sophistication if we're talking China and intellectual property theft especially. Should there indeed be a stronger focus on Chinese espionage, and why? And is it just China? You mentioned a couple of other countries.
Well, I will tell you, China's been around for a long time doing this. So for a guy like me that's been involved in this for a long time, I don't look at it as a new thing. China is very sophisticated, but I don't think corporations, especially in the private sector, should be focused on necessarily one country. The advent of cyber attacks and hacking has opened this up to a whole bunch of other nation states that traditionally 5 or 10 years ago would not have been attempting to compromise businesses, because they didn't have the resources, the assets, or the ability to put people, as we talked about earlier, inside the corporation. I think with the cyber threat nowadays has completely changed that. But what I would say is companies nowadays, especially when they're looking at the keys of the kingdom or the financial well-being of their company, if something gets stolen, need to be proactively talking to and bringing in people that actually understand how this threat can affect a corporation. And they should have a proactive plan in place that if this ever does happen, how they're going to handle an employee or employees within the company. You know, are they going to walk the employee out? Is it better to keep the employee in place? Do you attempt to monitor the employee's actions while him or her are in your company? You know, do you bring in some type of federal or local law enforcement organization? All these things are better discussed way in advance rather than trying to discuss it in the middle of a crisis.
Yeah, that's a very good point. And that leads us actually very nicely into the next section of my questions. And that relates more to insider risk investigations. Especially with your background, it would be very interesting to hear more about insider risk investigations and law enforcement involvement. Mm-hmm. And let's start with the interplay between a private company and law enforcement in investigations. Can you say a bit more about the split in occurrence between law enforcement instigated investigations involving a company and companies seeking help from law enforcement?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. It's evolved. That's the best way I can tell you. I mean, 20 years ago, I know for a fact the FBI would handle these investigations much differently than they do nowadays. I mean, nowadays we go into these investigations with a corporation as a partnership. In the old days, you would walk in and you would look at, okay, where's the criminal violations that happened? Who do we need to arrest? And you're not really looking at how's this going to affect the company financially? How is this going to affect if it's a publicly traded company? Is this going to affect stock price? You know, there was none of that years and years ago. Nowadays, a lot due to the advancements in the way that the FBI interacts with private sector corporations, we look at it as a partnership. I will tell you, though, in most countries, this is still completely voluntary by the corporation. In a lot of instances, and this is why going back to having a proactive conversation way before something happens, this helps whether you're going to involve federal or local law enforcement at all, or do you bring them in to help you figure out what's actually going on in your corporation? Because they may have information, especially if it's a nation state attack or if it's a sophisticated criminal organization, that can help you find out bits or pieces of your company that potentially has been compromised that you have no knowledge of. So you may think that you have the individual identified, you may think that you understand what has been stolen from your company when you may not have any idea, or it could be much more catastrophic than you think. So I think it's a balancing act. I can tell you from my experience, it's gotten much better in the recent times as opposed to the older days. But I think it's something that boards and executive leadership in any private sector company should have a conversation way in advance. And one of the major reasons is when you're thinking about bringing in an outside organization to help you, I think you should have a set of questions ready to ask them. Tell me how you're going to help my company. Tell me how my company is not going to get tied up in litigation or civil litigation because of this investigation. You know, 20 years ago, we would have looked at you and said, I have no idea what you're talking about. Nowadays, that is just a normal conversation. And it's a partnership. And I think you need, as the leadership of a company, I mean, surely as the CEO of the company that I run, I would be asking all those questions before somebody came in here, because you have to look out for the best of what's best for your company and obviously your investors or your shareholders.
Absolutely. And I can imagine if you're talking about a partnership and having that proactive conversation, it's important to have a face or a name to an agency that's behind it to actually build that trust also way in advance.
That's right. Yeah. Absolutely right.
Can you just provide an example in which law enforcement alerted the company to an insider, and what are these processes of cooperation?
Yeah, I will tell you my experience. A lot of times it's accidental. You are alerted to potentially something that's going on inside a large corporation because of potentially another investigation or intelligence information that's acquired. And then you would go out and have a conversation with the highest levels of that company, especially if it's a major compromise, or especially if it's involving the potential of, you know, thousands of people losing their jobs and financial welfare of thousands of citizens within your country or within a community. A lot of times nowadays, it's really a dual threat between individuals in corporations and a cyber threat going on simultaneously. And you may not know both of those are going on at the same time. You may just have a tidbit of information that you go to a corporation and say, listen, if I was you, I would look right here, wherever here is. And then let's see if that's valid. And at that point, again, the company has a decision to make. Can they handle this information and can they control this inside privately? Or do they think they need the help of federal or state or local law enforcement to help them ferret out the problem within their company? But a lot of times the clients or the private sector companies, when I was in the FBI or running large portions of the FBI, it was purely coincidental that we were able to identify a potential theft of large scale trade secret theft. And then when we started working with corporations, it would spider web out. And so what I mean by this is, and this goes back to companies probably won't even know this is going on. We may think there's one individual or one source within a company, and it may turn out to be 10 or 15 people within a company, again, compartmentalized off. No one knows the other person's working for this either nation state or criminal organization, and it becomes a much larger threat to that corporation.
I can imagine. And you're talking about cooperation with the private sector as well. Can you also mention some more complications in cooperation? What are the problems that you're stumbling upon in that relationship as well?
Yeah, that's another good question. I mean, one of the things I think all corporate leadership should be doing is you need to have a multi-stage plan for this, right? You need to have a marketing, a PR, a communications plan. You need to be able to tell your investors or board a specific story of what's going on. You need to be able to explain, why are we working with federal law enforcement? Why are we not working with federal law enforcement? If it's a publicly traded company, is this going to impact the stock price? Is this going to impact the overall value of my company? These are complicated, complicated questions. Do you have the general counsel of the company run this investigation, or do you bring in outside legal counsel, which I would highly advise to do? All these questions should be thought out way beforehand, because this is very complicated. And by the way, when these attacks happen, or when this actually comes out, you have a very short period of time to be able to control the narrative of your company, be able to calm the investors or your stock portfolio, that they understand that you now have something involved, but you have got this under control and it's not going to damage the company. I will tell you, in my experience, especially with insider threat, this is not thought about at all. When law enforcement or the company figures out that there is something going wrong, it turns into a major business interruption. It can severely damage the company. And nowadays, with the onset of internet reporting, and just about every major paper in the world is reporting live on the internet, you have a very short period of time or window to control that narrative. And one of the things we talk about when we go out to clients and partners that we work with is you must think about this in advance, and you must have the ability to control the narrative of what's going on in your corporation. I can tell you, unfortunately, I don't see that a lot. And I don't see companies taking the time to invest the money and resources, or bringing in individuals that know what they're doing to talk to them to help them set up a plan in advance. And it doesn't matter, as you all know, whether you're a teeny little company in inventing the next big widget that everybody's going to want to buy, or if you're a multi-billion dollar conglomerate that's a global corporation, it's the same amount of threat.
Yeah, so it's having these response plans in place, actually practicing them as well in advance, to really know what comes towards you, if it comes towards you, and having an appropriate response. And what you've been saying so far as well is it can be much more complicated than that one insider. Eh? There can be multiple insiders. It can be a combination of threats also between with a cyber component to it. So, yeah, it's very complicated. So I totally agree with you.
It's very complicated. And, you know, nowadays you walk into any company, and just about any company, depending on the size, will have some type of cyber incident response plan. They'll have some type of IT recovery or data recovery plan. 10 years ago, nobody had that. And so I keep putting insider threat back to where I saw cyber 10 or 15 years ago. And I just think that the private sector needs to wake up to this threat. And the one part which I will tell you, which in most of the cyber breaches or cyber investigations that I've been involved in the last 5 or 6 years since I've retired from the FBI, it's a lot of times an insider that is not a malicious threat to the company. And that's a whole nother aspect to this, where it is a threat to your corporation, but they're not necessarily there as a malicious insider. They've just done something that has now compromised your network.
And can you say a little bit more about that? Because do you sometimes also get involved in investigations where an insider is unwittingly utilized, actually? They're just a pawn in a bigger play, but they're not themselves not aware at all. Do you see that oftentimes happening as well?
Absolutely. And I think we would all very much relate to this. You know, our entire lives anymore are on your cell phone. So whether it's social media, whether it's your personal email accounts, whether it's your business email accounts, your Rolodex is now between family and friends and business associates. And the bad guys and the bad gals in this world, whether they're criminal in nature, hacktivists in nature, or a nation state, exploit that. The best way that I can say that, and people should take the time to go look up the Sony attack in the United States, which from the FBI's perspective, I was over top of from the day it happened. And the ability to look at your phone as the instrument of how you communicate across all of those networks is risk. And the reason I say it's risk is because you open up vulnerabilities that you don't even know you have. You go into a social networking situation and most people have hundreds, if not thousands of contacts. And let's face facts. Most of us have no idea who those people are. Or are they somebody malicious trying to gain access to me so that when I plug back into my corporate network, I can destroy your company. Or I can get in and download and move laterally and bypass all the security procedures that we've all put in place. So nowadays, people need to look at the threat differently. And one of the things I'll tell you from like the old days of law enforcement, you know, for me to go out and talk to you or arrest you or interview you, I had to know you. I had to find you. I had to touch you. I had to be in your vicinity. Nowadays, especially through social networking and other type of attacks, as you just brought up, that individuals could be clicking on something that they believe is a real email. They believe it's a real communication for somebody in their global company, but it's not. It's there purely to lead you down a road that will allow malicious access. And it's not that we all have to walk around petrified by that, but I think we need to look at it nowadays as a threat vector, because that's the way the bad guys and big gals do it. Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and going back to insider investigations, do you know how organizations themselves make the judgment call when to involve local law enforcement or the FBI? Yeah. And at what point do they have a choice? When does it become compulsory?
Well, you know, there's a difference. So when you look at insider threat and you look at how we monitor for insider threat nowadays, especially after Bob Hansen in 01 in the U.S. intelligence community, and then surely after Edward Snowden, there was a complete revamping of the entire United States intelligence community on how we looked at different things. That is really completely different than how the private sector does it. In the private sector, outside of these organizations where you all have top secret and secret clearances, you know, you basically sign your life away to be able to be monitored, looked at, followed, whatever. And I think that's right in that space because you're trusted with the nation's secrets. But in the private sector, there's a balancing act. You have to balance individuals' privacy and their right to maintain a privacy within their own life with the balance of how does the company make sure that our intellectual property or trade secrets that we put $1 billion in R&D into stay ours. And so there's a balancing act. And I think each company, quite frankly, it's definitely this way in the United States. And I think so in Europe also. Each company's got to make that personal decision because you don't want to be big brother. You don't want to intrude on people's privacy. But you do have a right to protect what you're developing for the market. And I think companies have to have those conversations. You have to have legal counsel involved in that. You have to have people that are very familiar with the HR rules within the different counties, cities, and governments and countries that you're working in. If you're a global company, GDPR or privacy enters into that with data. So again, not to make it too complicated, but I think you really need to have insight from people that have done it. In the US government or in intelligence organizations, slightly different. You can be very intrusive and you can expect nobody to push back on that. I think in private sector companies, you have to balance your employees' rights with what the rights of the company are. And depending where you're at in this world, it's going to be slightly different.
Yeah, but I can also imagine from a government point of view, the US government is focusing very much on economic espionage right now. I can imagine you would want all companies to alert the FBI at an early stage of suspicious activity. On the one hand, because the FBI might have a better understanding and context of the threat. Yeah. On the other hand, yeah, it's just for real visibility purposes. So are you able to, you're ex-FBI now, but to what extent do you think the FBI is able to communicate this through to the private sector?
Well, it's completely voluntary. Outside of something that would be a national interest to the country, right, which very seldom that will ever happen in these instances. It's usually a company that's looking at severe losses because something was stolen. It's completely voluntary. In the cases even where we bring an incident to a corporation, they may or may not want to work with the FBI. Mm-hmm. I will tell you, since my time of leaving the FBI, I have been astonished by how many companies that we will respond to help them with cyber breaches or ransomware or any types of an attack, even insider threat attacks, that do not want anything to do with the federal law enforcement system. And it's a personal decision with the company. The one thing I will highly recommend to any CEO or board that talks to me is if you're experiencing some type of sophisticated attack inside your company, whether it's a nation state attack or a significant criminal organization, I think it's worth talking to government organizations that may have information that can help you ferret out what's going on quicker. And in a lot of cases, that results back to nation state attacks or very sophisticated criminal organizations. But it's still very much voluntary outside of a national security issue in this country.
Okay. All right. So it really depends actually also on the relationship that you mentioned before, and that building that trusted relationship proactively might actually help organizations to reach out a little bit more if they are encountering a suspicious activity.
Absolutely. One thing I do encourage is with any corporation, but definitely ones that are in development of significant intellectual property, you should know and you should reach out to the local heads in the United States of every FBI office that's in your territory. I mean, you should be able to talk to the head of that office and say, hey, I'm the CEO of a corporation here in Dallas, Texas, or wherever you're at. And if something goes wrong, I want to know if I can call you guys. And this is the difference between the way the FBI really looks at this globally, quite frankly, nowadays, not just in the US, compared to the way we did 20 years ago. That should be a normal conversation. You shouldn't be asking, like, who do I call? Who do I talk to on the day of an event? And having these relationships early and being to have conversations early on, as you just said, really facilitates that easy integration of, hey, should I get you involved in this? But bigger than that, if I get you involved in this, tell me exactly what you're going to do. Tell me exactly how you're going to interact with my company. Tell me, do I have control of information that you may or may not want to use potentially in a criminal prosecution? And how much is that going to tie my company up? These conversations, quite frankly, are quite routine nowadays as opposed to several years ago. So I would highly recommend that. And we look at that, or the FBI nowadays looks at that the same way globally, because it's a small world nowadays and people are just connected everywhere.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and yeah, we were talking about the private sector. You also have private sector contractors, contracting parties working for the US government. Would that, yeah, do they need to involve the FBI immediately in cases of suspicious activity? Are there rules or, is there anything compulsory for their organizations? Do they fall under an insider risk policy umbrella for the US government as well?
Yeah, it's a good point. I mean, it depends. And it depends if the contractors for a company, even if it's in a private sector, are people working on unclassified information or potentially in military defense or anything like that, working on classified information. And obviously, depending on how classified it is, depending on how intrusive background investigations and financial investigations get. You know, we've had a lot of incidents in this country, and I mean, Ed Snowden was part of one of those, where individuals had worked for multiple intelligence organizations, had worked for multiple contractors inside the United States, had passed backgrounds, had passed security interviews, but along their line, they have become a train wreck when it comes to potentially being an insider threat problem. And for whatever reason, those individuals have slipped through those different checkpoints, and then eventually something goes wrong. And then it doesn't maybe necessarily go wrong because of an individual's skills at hacking or whatever, but lapses within security. So, I mean, there's different policies and procedures on that. I would say, like in any instance, and it doesn't have to be classified information, a lot of information that's compiled nowadays from different corporations on its own is not classified at all. But when you put it all together, because different companies are building different pieces of a widget, it becomes highly classified. So when you have a contracting crew within your corporation, as we all know, some corporations have hardly any contractors, other corporations have thousands. I think that you need to definitely make sure and review the different individuals that you're working with and their backgrounds. If I can say one other thing on that, in any spy or on any incident that I've seen, whether it's a significant intellectual property theft, trade secret theft from a private sector, or a spy in the United States government, there's a bell curve. Like, you or I get into one of these investigations and you have no idea where on that bell curve you just entered in. Did Bob already steal the biggest widget in the world and I'm now trying to leave with it? Or is Bob just now being recruited by somebody, which is under a long development phase, to help them significantly add access into that company? So with contractors that travel a lot, that may be in and outside of the United States, I would definitely look at how you're vetting these individuals, how you constantly revamp individuals and interview individuals after they've traveled abroad or traveled to specific countries, because it's never a straight line. You either get in involved in one of these things when it's already over. It might've been over for 20 years when you first investigate one of these things, and now you're trying to piece it back together, or it may have just happened, but you don't know that until you get into the investigation.
Yeah, good point. Very much so. And you mentioned the Snowden case a couple of times already, with him starting as a contractor, moving into the CIA, then having several different contracting roles, moving from Dell then to Booz Allen Hamilton. So you're just seeing constantly small pieces of the puzzle, basically. You've been involved in the Snowden investigation yourself, or you've been leading the Snowden investigation yourself.
Yep.
Can you tell us a little bit more on how that went, actually? He was working for Booz Allen Hamilton at the time. How did actually the whole situation arise? Who knew first as well? How did that evolve?
Well, it's funny. I mean, when I was the executive assistant director of the FBI, how this all basically evolved was, you know, Mr. Snowden had been working as a contractor inside one of the U.S.'s very highly classified intelligence organizations in Hawaii. And for me, I got first notified about this, that they had basically a missing person that had come up missing and had not shown up for work for a few days. And no one at that point had any idea that there was anything stolen from any place. And that, as you may expect, very rapidly changed in the next several hours and days with a variety of very aggressive investigative procedures by the FBI, as well as many other organizations around the world, quite frankly, not just in the United States, that were trying to help us figure out what happened. The one thing that I can say that the certain countries that Mr. Snowden had either been in, talked to, been around, in no way, shape, or form ever tried to help any of us to figure out exactly what was going on, which isn't surprising. But it's a perfect example of when you have somebody inside, I don't care if it's a private sector company or it's at the highest levels of the United States government or any foreign government. When somebody's inside, they have become, whether anybody agrees with it or not, a trusted employee within that company or agency. And I think it shows you how significant the damage can actually become by somebody that's inside and is actually trusted, and how quickly it can happen nowadays. In the old days, as I brought up to you, you know, the spies that we used to arrest, you would catch them doing all the traditional things you read in books. You know, they take a stack of documents and put it next to a tree in the middle of nowhere, and it'd be this cloak and dagger thing, which was all real, by the way. And you would follow people. Nowadays, it's not that at all. In minutes, you can lose the keys to the kingdom and substantially damage a country, an organization, or a private sector company. And I really, really think that's a perfect example of a way of showing how dangerous an insider actually is.
Yeah, asking about that a little bit more. What makes insider investigations different and more complicated for an organization compared to regular incidents, more generated by external threats?
Well, I mean, I think one of the things is, and I will tell you from experience, I mean, if you're investigating one of your own, and by the way, I mean, everybody thinks the FBI just arrested Bob Hansen. Unfortunately, the FBI have arrested, and I've been involved in at least arresting three people inside the FBI. It's hard. And if somebody would have ever walked into my office and said, Bob, I need to sit down with you because we think you're a spy, I would have had a pretty negative reaction to that. So whether it's a private sector corporation or you're inside a government organization in any country in the world, you really need to be sure before you destroy somebody's career or psychologically, and I mean this seriously, damage somebody by walking into the door and think you stole something either from our company or from our government, or you're providing this for any of the reasons I brought up earlier. And I think one of the things about insider threat investigations is you need to be meticulous and cautious and not necessarily overreaching. You need to do it in a very measured way. Because whether it's a private sector employee or anybody in a government organization around the world, it's a significant thing to walk in a door. Trust me, I've done it too many times in my career to look at somebody that you know and accuse them of either stealing your intellectual property or being a spy. And the people that have never done that don't understand it. It's a significant thing. So whether it's a private sector corporation or a government entity, you really need to be sure before you start accusing anybody of illegality inside those organizations.
Yeah. Yeah, and you're mentioning the investigations that you've conducted inside the FBI as well. I think you mentioned three of them already. How do you think it can happen within an agency itself that's seemingly more aware and more secure than you would expect from a private sector organization?
And here's my answer, and it's going to sound simple, but it's not. It's people, and people make mistakes, and people are fallible, and people have bad days, and we're all part of that. And so, you know, the key to any of this, in my opinion, regardless of where the person sits, it has no bearing whether they're inside a government organization or a private sector company, is I'll go back to that bell curve. The guy that Bob Anderson was at 20 years old may or may not be the guy that Bob Anderson is at 50 some years old. May or may not be. You have to have a way of determining or checking in along that person's career without violating privacy or guidelines or human resources or anything like that to make sure that person in a position of trust, regardless of where he or her sits, is still along that same trajectory. Most people, 90-some percent of the people that I've been involved in investigating or arresting for spying or economic espionage have had something go on in their life. Could be anything. A loss of a loved one, a divorce, a drug dependency. I can go on and on and on. And all of a sudden, within that person's life, it changes. For whatever reason, they might have been vulnerable to a recruitment attempt, or they might have been vulnerable to bribery, or they might have done something they didn't want anybody to know about, and now they're being extorted. There's got to be a way to look at that. And again, there's ways to do it, and you don't have to do it in any way that you're violating a person, especially outside of a government organization's privacy or rights. But you need to check in on Bob. Somewhere along that 30-some year career, we just want to make sure Bob's still Bob, right? And if there's a bump in that, let's stop and look at it for a second. Doesn't mean Bob's a spy, doesn't mean he's fallen off the tracks, but we need to check in on it. And that honestly, in my opinion, is very lacking in a lot of private sector companies, even companies that develop pretty sophisticated technology. They either don't have the experience or they don't have the background, or people within those corporations don't have the background to say, hey, wait a minute, Let's talk about this for a second, because I've seen this, right? And it does happen. It's a good conversation to have, actually. It's actually a very good question.
Yeah, so what you're saying is that despite the security measures that you can be taking, it is really about people. So to check in on people regularly in employment is a key factor as well. And I'm just thinking of even employees that have already left an agency, like Kevin Mallory. Things can happen years after they've even left. So yeah, it is very complicated in that sense, and people can still carry with them a lot of information that remains relevant.
Sure. I mean, I've been gone 6 years, and I mean, the stuff in my head's not leaving, right? And so that's a whole nother threat that we could spend hours talking about. But what do you do with people when they leave your company, right? How do you make sure that those individuals are not going to take what's in their head and take it to a different corporation? And no different within government organizations, right? All the stuff that I've been involved in and all the stuff that I know, it's still sitting in my head. And so it's a whole different threat vector, but it's something to be talked about. And the one thing that I've advised corporations or boards that have asked me that question is, what type of disclaimers are your general counsel putting in front of these employees before they leave? What are you getting them to sign to make sure that that does not leave your company? And if it does, the fact that you're going to come to them first and interview them first about who or how or why. It's just that extra step, and it's really a good thought process on this, because the one thing, people, especially people that are very technically oriented, they don't need to steal the schematics, especially if they build it. That's all still sitting inside of their head. So it's something to be concerned about at times, but proactive about definitely.
Yeah, indeed. Yeah. Another question really is, we've been talking about private sector and the activities that they should, that corporations should conduct in their insider risk programs. Yeah. You mentioned a couple of incidents within law enforcement, within the FBI. Mm-hmm. What lessons should law enforcement learn when dealing with insider threats? What can law enforcement within the organization themselves do better?
Well, I think one of the biggest things is access and need to know. The FBI was pretty good about that, quite frankly, the entire time I was in there, but yet we still ended up arresting people that had compromised that. Again, I hate to keep bringing it up, but Snowden was definitely a line of demarcation in the entire U.S. intelligence community after that happened. But really, it's access. And why do you need access? And it should never be because I want it. It should be there's a need. And I will tell you, some companies are really good about this. Some are not. It's kind of happenstance about why are different employees brought into. And then if they are brought into different levels of proprietary trade secret investment, should those employees then sign waivers to allow the company to monitor all email communications, to put banners up within the computer systems that basically tell anybody logging in that all of this is monitored? And are there alarms generated when certain levels of downloads happen inside of a company? And if those downloads leave to go to a different IP address that is recognized, they're blocked. There's a bunch of things you can do nowadays. And we can talk about this for a significant amount of time, specifically in the technology side, that will allow companies to make sure that stays within their inner circle. But in to answer your question directly, it's why do you need access? The conversation should start there. And it shouldn't be just because I want it or just because of my position. It should be a need for that.
Mm-hmm. And then maybe the final question and most important question, we've been talking about the threats. We've been talking about a lack of experience and a lack of programs. What advice do you have for organizations that don't have insider risk or insider threat programs yet? And maybe associated with that, how would you define success of a program? What are the most key ingredients?
Yeah, I think first of all, foremost, if you're worried about it, that's great because you're way ahead of most companies. But if you're not worried about it, you should start thinking about it and you should start having those conversations. Once you have the conversations at a leadership level and you decide, hey, listen, this is something we need to do, you need to talk to people that know what they're doing. This is a very highly specialized area that I can tell you, a lot of companies may tell you they have experience or understanding in this. I think if you're a private sector company, buyer beware, make sure you're talking to the right men and women that actually know what they're doing and have experience with this. And then second of all, when it comes to judging an insider threat program, one of the best ways I've seen it done, quite frankly, because you can go out and poll any private sector company. And if you went and asked somebody, hey, would you turn in Bob that sat next to you for the last 10 years if you thought he was doing something wrong? I will tell you, most people will tell you, I'm not getting involved in that. Or the only way I'm going to get involved in that is if my identity is completely neutral, right? You have no idea who just sent this into you. So one of the best ways I've seen this done, quite frankly, is making the culture of the company part of guarding your secrets, right? And there are major companies out there that have done this unbelievably well for, you know, over 100 years. But the culture of the company has got to be one of, not that we are looking at every person suspiciously, but it's a culture of security around our company. And then anonymize individuals that may want to send an email saying, hey, listen, Jane or Sam came into our office the last four weekends in a row. I've worked with them for 20 years. They've never come into this office on the weekend, and I don't know what's going on. There should be a way of making that neutral. And what I've seen with companies that have done that, what you see is a higher rate of security, not with the security guards necessarily, but within the company. You walk around office space, and even though you haven't told them to, all of a sudden there's no papers laying on anybody's desk. You go in the middle of the night and drawers are locked. There's a nature of this is our company and we're going to protect it. I think that's the best way to look at a culture of security. You can't look at it as a one-off. Like we're just going to go out and hunt to find the individual. That's not going to happen. It needs to be a nature and a culture of security. And I think the companies that have done that, it's worked unbelievably well.
Yeah, it's a very good point talking about culture, because it's with the work that we are doing, that's a topic that comes over and over in time again back. It's all about the profession. It's not even a security culture. It's about a professional culture as well, which incorporates security too.
That's right.
So it's really key. And you say you've seen organizations that do that well. How do you think they went about doing getting that culture integrated within their way of working?
That's a good point and a good question. I mean, a lot of the companies, because the corporation actually originated with some type of trade secret, they've made that part of their brand, part of their persona from the very beginning. And so from the very start, it has happened. Now, other companies, I've seen this with a few tech companies, that although they started as a small company, they grew very rapidly. And honestly, due to the leadership of the CEO and executive leadership within the company, one of the cultural parts of the company was, you know, our security around the products we make for clients or partners. And I think it's a mindset. And I think it's something that doesn't have to be equated with bad. This is surrounding our company and what we, not me, we are doing as a team to make our company successful. And I think that's really it. And honestly, it can start anytime in a company's history. I think you and I would agree it's easier to start from the beginning, because then everybody as the company grows is indoctrinated with the same kind of ideas and ideologies. But you can start this in any time. It doesn't necessarily need to be a bad thing. And then the other thing I would suggest to any leadership to have an open conversation with your employees. Listen, we are developing very seriously a significant technology that we're going to go to market with, and this is the keys to our kingdom. And here's why we're going to start this program. And by the way, we are very conscious of your privacy and rights, and that we're not going to violate any of that, and that we are not going to be Big Brother, but we are going to take the time and the initiative to make sure that we protect what belongs to this company. Part of what goes on with this, and it's just like spying, you know, people read in books and they think, you know, some of that's true, most of it's not, and how this actually works. And so being able to help lead a company down that, I think, is a good way to go, because most of the time, if you're upfront and you explain what you're doing and make sure you preface that we're not violating anybody's rights, I think that's a big part of this. Easier to start at the beginning, but I think you can start it at any time in a company's history.
Indeed. So even with startups, especially in the technology sector as well, these are topics that are also very important to get started with. Indeed, better to start at the beginning than to be a large corporation and then make changes. A culture is difficult to change, but easier to set up at the beginning. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I think that's a really good thought to leave all of us with. Except if you have other comments that that you feel like we should be addressing, or any other topics that you feel like are important to actually take note of.
No, I mean, I think we've talked about it in a broad sense very well. I want to take time to compliment you for taking the time to bring this in front of your clients and your friends and the people that you trust and work with all the time, because I think it really is a needed conversation. I don't think companies take it as seriously as they should. And it's probably because of the lack of knowledge of how rampant something like this actually does take place. So kudos to you. I think this is a great conversation and obviously could go on for a long time. So thank you.
Well, thank you very much too, Bob. It's very really fantastic to hear your expertise. Indeed, this conversation could go on for a very long time. I would have loved to hear the stories. Storytelling is also very powerful, and you have lots of experience with so many cases. But until now, thank you very much for your time and for your expertise.
Thank you so much.
All right, thank you.